Okay, so we are ready to convene the Wednesday, the first meeting of the Northampton Community Preservation Committee. On tonight's agenda, we have general public comments to start, then approval of minutes of March 18, 2015, a brief chair's report, and then we will begin our funding recommendations for this round of 2015. So, general public comment, if you would step up and tell us your name and address so that the staff can record it. And since we do, we'll have spending a long time on funding recommendations, if you could limit yourself to 3 minutes, that would be excellent.
Can I start?
Yeah.
Hi, everybody, good evening. I'm Jenny Flominize, I live at 15 Dryads Green, Northampton. And I'm here in support of the Pulaski Park project that's before you tonight. I've had a long interest in Pulaski Park as a downtown work person and as the mother of children and grandchildren. I was privileged to go to the 3 charrettes that were held at the senior center, which were really well attended, lots of community input. And I'm here to urge you to really pass this tonight. It's a project that's long overdue. I would like to see it done right and not chipped away at, so I just like you to pass it as it is and not chip away. We were asked a vision, what we would like at the 3 meetings that we had, without regard to the cost. That might be a little dangerous, and I know many people have talked about the cost, but I really think that this is a terrific project, a terrific group of architects that put together. There was a huge amount of community input, and I strongly urge you to pass it. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Mary Casper. I live on High Street in Florence. I'm currently the chair of the Ad Hoc Roundhouse Lot Development Advisory Committee. So I'm speaking here tonight as a private citizen. I'm here to speak in support of the Pulaski Park project. I cannot think of another project that will come before your committee for funding that will have a greater impact on Northampton and our downtown. Pulaski Park and the buildings that surround it are the very heart of our community, our public square. When I was the city's arts coordinator, I had the great good fortune to work in Memorial Hall. I ate my lunch in Pulaski Park every day when the weather permitted. I can speak firsthand to how much the park is used by our community. I can also speak to the great love that folks have for our park. I've been to almost every meeting about Pulaski Park since the days of the Hilton Hotel project, from meetings held by Bob Reckman's committee, to the meetings the DPW held to select a landscape architect for the project, to the current round of meetings held by the Stimson Associates. There was public involvement in every one of these meetings because people truly care about their park. I'd like to assure your committee that the costs of the project were discussed and questioned at these meetings. The press was there and articles were in the Gazette. I do think that there's been a good deal of publicity about the price tag. Yes, it is a lot of money, but it has been money well spent with a tremendous return for our CPA dollars. While the city continues to work to get grant money, this renovation and expansion of Pulaski Park would not be possible without CPA funding. I hope you will support this project. Thank you.
Anyone else? Please step right up.
My name is Steph Jacobs, and I live at 82 Grove Avenue, Leeds. I'm a little out of breath because it's so hard to find a parking. I think one of the reasons that the CPA was set at 3% instead of 1 or 2% is so that there would be a big enough pot of money that a project like Pulaski Park could be funded. And I really appreciate the fact that you all have, over the years, funded a variety of projects, some very small and some much larger. And I hope that you'll seriously consider funding it, because I think it's an excellent use of money. It's something that does need to be done. I also just wanted to briefly comment on the iconic Christmas tree, which came up at the last hearing that you had. And I think that although it would be sad not to have it, that the new spot will have some real pluses on its own. It'll be near the children's play area, so that they'll be able to see it in other times of the year. And I think the other thing it can do is bring people into the park when it's lit. I also doubt very seriously if it would survive with all the concrete around it. That has to be taken up, and I think it would have some severe root damage. So I'm hoping that you'll feel the same way I do and fund the project. Thank you.
Thank you. Any additional comments?
Hi, I'm Kirby, 134 North Street. I just want to speak about something I've spoken about before, which is about process. I went to find the minutes for the last three meetings. You try to find the minutes on the website. And after all this time, the meetings' minutes are not being posted in a timely manner. And it's impossible for the public. It may just be the ornate structure of the website itself that's the problem, but you need to let the public know what's going on. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any additional comments? Hearing none, the next item on the agenda is the approval of minutes from our March 18th, 2015 meeting. And I believe these have been distributed with some changes already suggested. And if there are any others, are we ready to move these for approval?
With due respect to the comment that we just heard, you know, we just got these minutes, the revised version yesterday, which it's not sufficient time to review it, especially that was a meeting where we didn't have any, it wasn't covered by TV or by NCTV, and that's going to be the only record of that conversation. It was an extended meeting with extended public comment, and I feel like the meeting minutes as drafted aren't as full as they should be to capture the dialogue that was there, and that, I encourage all of us to take a close look at it to make sure that I'd like to move the table until we have a chance to look at it.
Okay, well, so if there's no motion to approve, then we can postpone these until the next meeting. We'll need to make sure that they reflect what happened at that meeting, and we'll do that before we then we finalize your decisions for this round next meeting. Is that without objection, or is anything?
I got two of them. I made some corrections that I gave this year. I think when we do have a meeting like that where we have a lot of people, the important thing to do is to capture the name and the topic and the general flavor of yes or no. And I think beyond that, it's asking a lot to get the verbatim.
All right. The chair's report, I would just note, as I'm sure you've all seen, the latest email from Stuart Saginaw at the Community Preservation Coalition that the news in terms of reimbursement is as low as it's been. But of course, that makes their attempt to secure funding from the surplus, end of year surplus, even more important. So the political effort to try to make that happen in the legislature is now important. They were successful before for 1 year, but they couldn't create a sustained mechanism. So this would be important to try to reach out to our legislators and also see if our constituents who support the CPA would be willing to do so. So what I'm talking about is that the Community Preservation Act funding is supplied by fees that are collected at the Registry of Deeds. And so we, as a community, get a match percentage, and this year it's an 18% match for our local revenue that's created as part of the 3% surcharge that is on property tax bills. In the past, the match has been as high as 100% during the, that was at the beginning. Now as more communities signed up, the match has dropped. When the match dropped, there was an effort to get the legislature to take $25 million from the end of year surplus, when basically unexpended funds are returned to the surplus at the end of the year, and apply that to the CPA trust fund. So that was done for 1 year, but that has not been continued because the Department of Revenue said that they could, it was not legal to create a mechanism to do that year on year. So there's now an effort, and if you support the CPA, it would be worth reaching out to your legislators and to contact them and try to enlist their support for making that happen this year, because it's critical to increasing our match percentage and allowing us to have more CPA funding to fund projects like this one.
So
Satnor
and Company, the group that certifies the lobbying of the legislature on our behalf, has hired another person, and we pay a fee into that fund that funds his efforts. So I'm curious whether you are, whether you think that's a good thing or a concern, a thing of concern.
They have run a very small shop and have been fairly successful. I would say if they hire another person but it doesn't bear fruit, then we would have to evaluate whether or not that's the best use of the dues.
Thank you.
All right, so we are now to the point of beginning funding recommendations for round one of 2015. We have ranking sheets expressing whether members of the committee wanted to fully fund, partially fund, or not fund particular applications. Is there any preference of the committee as to whether we begin with the top rank or the lowest rank application?
I think this is a good time to tell everyone how much money we actually have at this point, because I'm not sure everyone's aware that we only have a small amount of money. We don't have enough to fund everything.
Well, so as the committee knows, we have approximately, Sarah, $185,000. So $185,000 currently in our accounts. However, the Community Preservation Act does expressly provide that the legislative body, and that would be the City Council in the City of Northampton, can issue bonds and with the and deposit the proceeds of the bonds in the community preservation accounts. So that's what we've done before when we didn't have current revenue to allow us to fund, for instance, the masonry work for Forest Library, the acquisition of the Bean Allard Farm, or the creation of the Florence Fields Recreation Lands. So it's true that we have $185,000, which does not allow us to fund everything that's on the wish list. But however, that's why we have talked about in last round, actually, and this round about bonding, which we would have to, again, we would only recommend it, but of course it would be up to the City Council to make that decision. So if there's no strong preference, I think we could probably begin with the first ranked project, which is Pulaski Park. This is a request for $1.675 million. And so we have in the past begun with a motion with an amount attached.
I'll make a motion to fully fund the reconstruction of Pulaski Park. The amount of $1,675,000.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion.
First, I want to thank the Gazette for running some papers, because I, in addition to funding the park this year, what that means is we are putting at it an indemnity on all of the future projects for a while. So, I appreciated the public process. We've had a lot of support for the park, and I needed that sort of voice to feel okay about affecting all of our future projects for a while. So I would love to see if we could come to a bond amount that's less than that full amount
and phase the funding between the overlook, the additional piece that was added, and go back for another park grant, and not bond any penny more than we have to. That would be my hope. As I do think there's been a good series of stories in the paper, and I think that's the best use of our paper, I really do.
My feeling is actually very similar to Devin's. On my ranking sheet, I was suggesting funding phase one. I think this is the only way this park is going to get done. I think it is critically important to, and a wonderful use of CPA funds, but I am concerned about the next projects that will also be in their own way potentially important contributors to the community. So managing it, it's a big number, and there's only so much manipulation we can do, but to the extent we can do any, I would like to try to do that. So a phase one, I would be supportive of, as well as I understand from Sarah that the bond, it would not go into take effect until next round of dollars, but I would be supportive of setting aside some of this round's money as a down payment and to reduce the amount that ultimately we have to bond.
Comments?
You know, I'm okay with using some of this round's money to keep that bond amount down, but I am a big fan of supporting the whole project. You know, I talked to a lot of people, and a lot of people automatically, yes, I haven't heard a no yet in regard to doing this project. Everyone says it's a lot of money, but I haven't heard anyone say don't spend the money. And I just think that, having spent a lot of time there in the last couple of weeks and talking to a lot of people in the last couple of weeks, I think there's support for it. I understand it's going to affect large projects. It's going to affect other projects in the next few years. That's why we need to put some time into considering what the bond term is going to be and what kind of money we can expect to have. If it's $300,000, $400,000 per go around, then that's what it is. Maybe that invites more smaller projects. Again, when I put this motion forward, it didn't go without thought. I put a lot of thought into this. And I like to be fiscally responsible also, but downtown needs it. The roundhouse area needs it. The businesses here need it. And it's a park that every taxpayer, visitor, everyone who is in this city gets to enjoy. You go downtown now, where do we go? You get a sandwich, you eat inside. You know, my wife and I, we get a sandwich, we drive to Charles Park now. So why can't we walk across the street and go to Charles Park? So I get it, and I agree with you, Devin, and I agree with you, Mike, that this is a lot of money. But I also think that there's a lot of support to spend it.
I actually support phase two. I think it doesn't make sense to do two-thirds of the park and then leave this ugly back end. But we don't know when we'll get the park grant, and I'm just so I would be supportive of doing both phase one and phase two, but in funding phases as well as actual construction.
Are there financial advantages to holding back $225,000 and just doing one in terms of bonding? Does that, Sarah, would that make sense? I mean, Jim seemed to indicate at the last meeting that he was fine with that, because phase two will not proceed without additional $400,000 park grant. Is that correct?
That is true. And the committee could also decide at some point in the future that you have enough cash on hand to be able to fund that phase.
The $225,000.
Yeah.
So our funding at the 1.375 amount would not in any way jeopardize the phase two construction budget, is that correct?
That seems to be what Jim indicated, because it's not moving forward until the next park grant is received.
And in fact could reduce the initial bonding amount, if in fact we at a later time would have that $225,000
fund. Potentially, yeah.
Stated another way,
Oh, that's okay.
stated another way, it means you're not borrowing money now that you're not going to use until later.
Sarah, is there any problem getting the park grant without the funds? Is there a timeline in regards to the funds being allocated and applying for the park grant?
I think the response that Jim had was that as long as the committee had a commitment prior to that, which would still be next year, then it would be sufficient. But they didn't have to provide it.
Is there, to clarify, you're saying that in terms of the application process or in terms of if they were to have a follow-on park grant to provide the funding prior to the July 1st, 2016 start?
So they would need to be, we need to have a commitment for 2016.
Right. Can I clarify something?
When we're talking, I've not been in a situation where we've extended over years the discussion of a project. Mm-hmm. So there would not need to be a reapplication. Can we now make a decision that phases it and commits us to next year's funding? We have the application, it's whole. So it can guide me on that?
This committee makes decisions based on the applications, and we have not in the past, because the membership of the committee can change. We have not made recommendations that survive past the term or past this committee's current sitting. So we have had the Habitat for Humanity houses in Florence was a situation like that where we desired to fund in multiple rounds, but we decided that we had to come back to it as a new application, at least in form.
Yeah, I wasn't on the committee then, so I didn't know that history. So to clarify, the city would need to reapply for the round of funding next year.
I would think so, and of course, because of the status or because of the posture of the project, we all have the information. So I don't know that the application, the application would be a submission of most of the information we've already seen.
So with the grin and a wink, the entire town wouldn't have to come out and convince us again.
Again, it might at that point. Again, I think we could the same process that we've gone through. Of course, with the information in our hands about what, obviously at that point we'd have part of the park constructed, and then we also have the park grant. We also have more information about what the final cost of the undergrounding of the utilities is, which, as we know, is now sort of an open-ended commitment that the city has to make in order to receive the $400,000 park grant. So I had a question about the construction supervision contracts. They're all the bidding, construction administration, construction observation. Are those, split roughly in half, or is there any?
That I don't know. I'm not sure the details of this project.
Any other comments? Go ahead.
So, I've been a proponent of the park revitalization, and I think our presentation from our last meeting, I thought it was extremely helpful. We gave $200,000 to come up with the design work, and I think at the end of that, it was a convincing, compelling argument for what needs to happen there. I think there are a lot of bells and whistles that we may not need in a park. That's part and parcel of the charrette. That's part and parcel of trying to be good by this community. And I think there's a cost issue, and we've all talked about this over and over again, kind of like having the unlimited budget and design the park that you want. We also have the constraints of our committee and the amount of money that we have available and that we may bond. And I think I kind of fall down somewhere in the middle as well in terms of funding. I would like to fund phase one now. I feel like there are some unresolved questions about what happens at Brown House. I feel like the overlook can be the driver for that, but it's not essential that we do it now. I would rather make that decision at a later time, see if that park grant is successful, and get in place as soon as we can the bulk of the park that we originally contracted and designed for. So I guess I would favor phase one at this point. The other issue is one that we heard about, and I keep getting emails about, and rightly so, is what's conceived of as the holiday tree. I know there are people who are disappointed that the tree may come down. And we've heard from the horticultural experts and silvicultural experts that the tree is not going to be long-lived as soon as construction begins. And I think that that's accurate. The concern I have is whether or not we should be using CPA dollars at a cost of $7,500 to be replacing a 18 to 22 foot tree at the back of the park. And my preference to resolve, you know, someone who doesn't celebrate Christmas, you know, I feel like that's a tax lien on my property to pay for a $10,000 tree that not everyone in the community is able to use. My preference would be to at least assuage some of that problem by saying maybe CPA funds shouldn't be used for that aspect. They can still draw on the park grant for that aspect, or they can do private fundraising to put in the tree. That would be the one concession that I would probably look for in order to get forward to phase one.
So, Sarah, if we were to fund the 1.375 million and defer the 225,000, then the city would have to rebond two cycles from now or whatever the additional 225,000, assuming that the park grant came in. Is that an onerous process for the city to now have to rebond, or are they always constantly bonding and they just attach another?
That would, I mean, generally the city goes out to bond for a few items every few years, so this would be attached to it. But
so it's not a burden.
With an amount that small, the community could always decide to fund it out of cash.
So theoretically, we wouldn't have to be bonding that at all. We would have our money built back up over the
And that's what the committee decided to do at that point. So the next fiscal year, which begins July 1st, we'll have a new pot of money for the committee to draw on.
So I have a name for this project. It reminds me of the Big Dig. I see that in the future, I mean, there's so many costs that we don't know about. We don't know about burying the utilities, and there's so much we don't know about. We don't know who will maintain this park. They told us that at the last meeting, that who's going to pay for that. We might have to, the city might have to hire somebody to maintain it. We don't know who's going to take care of all of these new shrubs and trees that are expensive. They also told us at the last meeting that it's only 25% done in the design phase, so they can go back and they can save the taxpayers some money by not building such an extravagant park. Because at the time that the people went to the charrettes, they didn't say, well, this water feature is going to cost this much money, and this, all of these big special designs and all of this changing on the trees. There was no price tag, and so of course people were excited. But I think now a lot of people are just concerned about paying their bills, especially, you know, the homeowners, especially with the stormwater costs, and every year it seems like we have more and more, there's an override. It's becoming very expensive to own property in this town. And a lot of people who are retiring, they're gonna have to leave this town. You know, we worry about the children who can't stay in this town because it's expensive. Well, we're going to lose a lot of people who are retiring who just can't keep up with all the bills. And just life is expensive now, the electricity, insurance. So I would ask the city not to spend so much money to take another look at this while they finish the other 75% of the design and try to save the taxpayer some money. So I would ask for just to fund only about $800,000 at this point. That's how I feel about it.
Yes. I feel like we have different understandings at this point of that. I feel like the maintenance was addressed at the last meeting, that DPW spoke to that and said that they told us what their projected hires were for the upcoming year and that that would be adequate. I don't think that's an unknown. And I know you probably had a hard time with parking because many of us were late, but what you didn't hear from public comment was people saying that the price tag has been part of this since the very beginning, and that there's been extensive public involvement. And so people who went to the charrettes and participated in the architect selection had, I'm just telling you what I heard.
I know that's what you heard, and it was It's not happening. We didn't have the price tag until.
I also heard from the mayor at the last meeting saying that the price tag was part of it from the beginning, so.
I'm sorry, I was at the meeting.
Wait, this is really a conversation between the members of the committee.
So I appreciate your concerns. I just feel like what you're saying isn't resonating what I heard.
I still, in my opinion, the price tag is too high for the taxpayers right now. And that it could be less. It doesn't have to be so extravagant. I'm not saying we do need a park, but we also need to try and conserve spending. And that's what I'm asking for. And maybe they did say at the charrette that it was going to cost $1.1675 million. But it's costing even more than that because we're going to be paying interest on this money. And the people who are paying it are the people who are paying real estate tax. So a lot of people who support it, they might not be the same people that are paying the real estate tax. I think it's only fair to be careful and try to design a park that is just less expensive.
Well, I guess I'd like to reiterate that speaking to a lot of people, they agreed that it was a lot of money, but they were okay spending it. My only concern with not funding the overlook is having the overlook. I think it's, to me, the best part of the park. And by delaying it, does that change when they get to the back end of the project? Is it less important? Do we all of a sudden stop because the money was, it was more expensive to get back than they thought it was going to be? Are they gonna submit another proposal as far as the cost of the overlook? That's my concern when you start taking a project and cutting it up a la carte. $1.6 million is a lot of money, but again, I can't stress enough the importance of it. It's right here, and there's a lot of support for it. We're being responsible, but there's a lot of support for this project.
That was sort of behind my question of Downey about what would happen next year, because I feel like in my contracting world, we will be half pregnant. And so that's the unknown about the second half. I hear you. It's generally more cost effective to do a project in its entirety all at once. But as I repeated before, we will be borrowing money that won't be spent for another year or two. So that sort of summarizes my concern. I think before us tonight is more the how. I hear you, and I've voiced my concern about the cost not being clear up front. But when the mayor came in on the round and told us about the price of other parks and towns in the area, I thought he was doing his due diligence to try to say what would a park cost.
I'm not sure that were those parks paid for with CPA funds.
No, he was just saying that the park itself. We might want an $800,000 park, but we may not be able to get a good $800,000 park. I think that was kind of what he was thinking. And last fall, I got the floor, Dave. You're concerned about the tree. Obviously, the park has trees, and so the park has evergreen trees. So until we put the lights on it, I think about it not as a Christmas tree.
My point is that it was presented as a Christmas tree. It was represented at the charrettes as a holiday tree or a Christmas tree. We're not replacing it with a $500 blue spruce that's 4 feet tall. We're replacing it with a 22 foot tall evergreen tree, which serves the function of being a centerpiece for a particular holiday. It's the concern. It's not one-to-one replacement for everything that's being lost. We're just concerned about an evergreen, we'll probably start with a much smaller evergreen. I share some of Marlene's concerns. I think we all have regarding cost, and I feel ultimately, that part and parcel. I think that it was clear what the cost would have been since the beginning. I mean, that's the request for the proposals is, this is how much it costs to design, and then we use a factor of 10 to estimate how much it costs to build. So it was clear that was going to be the price tag. That price tag has gone up incrementally. The overlook was in addition beyond the scope of work that we had originally recommended and that was authorized. It was an add-on that's another $600,000. that's part and parcel of why I feel comfortable delaying it for another round. I would like to get the chunk that we originally had a commitment to. And I do think that it's something that's important. I think it's something that allows for that connectivity. I think it's complementary, and I don't see that there would be any problem bringing it back before us. And it might be something that we could do cash in hand as opposed to bonding. Those initial years of interest were expensive, and add on an extra $200,000. That's money out of another project that we could do funding. So I feel comfortable with that trade-off. I think what would make me feel most comfortable moving forward with project, assuming it's something that we approve in some form, is when we communicate to the city council to, in one of our recital clauses, in those whereas clauses, explain just how much we struggled with the cost. That it's not something, and this was an unbounded project. And unlike those other gateway city projects that are $1 million, $2 million, $4 million in Pittsfield and Holyoke and Chicopee that were 75 and 100% funded by the state with different programs, we're being asked as a city to back a very expensive park. It's an acre of land for $1.6, $1.4 million. I think we have an obligation to explain when we dealt with that issue, how we dealt with that issue, and that ultimately it's the folks who are proposing this project, the DPW and the mayor's office, job to provide that information to the city council as well and say, here's why it costs what it costs. You know, we can take issue with lots of different elements. You know, I'm not convinced that we need a rail to walk bikes up and down a set of stairs for the overlook. But in its totality, I agree with Glenn. This is a vital part of our city. This is something that benefits all the people, right? Unlike school grounds, where it's mostly families, unlike some of our other projects, which are historic for people who were in urban history. This is the heart of our downtown. So I feel like that's where, although I'm uncomfortable with the figure, yes, it would have been nice to see different models for 400,000, 800,000. You know, I do believe in what's been presented would be beneficial. And for that reason, I support it.
Other comments?
Can we talk about real dollars? So when we talk about, I appreciate paying interest on money, we're not using this money, but can we just talk about how much, what's the difference? You know, what are we, if we cut off that $225,000, what is the difference in terms of what we're going to pay for the bonding?
Yeah. I think it all depends on the time of bond.
How long the bond
yeah.
is. Yeah, but and the figures that we had were for the full amount.
We don't know exactly what the interest rate will be, and we're not quite sure what the term will be, so it's sort of in the middle of the road here. So we had been given scenarios with 1.5, and we had a three-year bond anticipation note at 2% for a total interest cost of $60,000. What that would take away from the committee's ability to appropriate for or to recommend for other projects would be $530,000 a year, which if we have roughly between 800,000 and a million, depending on match, that's half. That's for 3 years. At 5 years, the cost goes to 90,000, and the debt service is approximately 325,000. At 10 years, that bond goes to 4%. Instead of getting the 2% that you would get for the shorter terms, and the cost goes to $330,000.
So when does it go to, when does it double?
So the cost that John projected were 2% for the bond anticipation note, 2% for a 5 year, and again, 5 year would be another bond anticipation note, and then finally 10 years, it would go out to a bond at 4%.
Just for discussion purposes, is there anyone that would entertain a 10-year note on this for $330,000?
No. I just want to make one comment about cost, because since we saw the design proposal 2 years ago, and at that point in the application states pretty plainly that based on the 2008 design competition, they estimated a cost of $1,450,000, an additional $30,000 for construction supervision. That's without the overlook. So when I total up this project without the overlook, I have $1,450,000. And that's including the $200,000 for the additional undergrounding utilities. So I remember that very well because I remember thinking that's a sizable sum. But then we do know that those projects, and again, they have different sources of funding. It seems like that is an amount that you are faced with if you want to have a top quality urban park that's going to draw people or allow people to enjoy the park. And I guess my concern is that I wouldn't want to spend an amount of money that would spruce the park up and make it functional, but not really make a huge difference. Because again, we know that the park back in the bicentennial, that some cosmetic changes were made, but the park never really functioned because it wasn't realigned properly, it wasn't designed properly. And a badly designed park will be harder to maintain, and then it will fall into disuse again. So I guess my thought is that we did fund a top-notch design team to give us an idea, and they designed successful urban parks. So my inclination is, again, I think we already, from our discussions, from their presentation, they're already in the process of value engineering. They're already in the process of, they're not going to get everything they wanted. So they have already begun to try to control the budget within this 1.45 million. So they didn't exceed it. The additional is the overlook. But again, that's something that because of the phasing, you have the ability, if for some reason the park grant doesn't come in, the overlook doesn't happen right away. Or unless the community thinks that the new revised park is so great that the overlook should be made, then maybe that would be something that the CPA could look to funding a larger portion of, again, depending on a smaller park grant. So I just wanted to point that out, that the escalation of the cost is largely due to extension of the overlook, which was not anticipated when we began the process.
Well, and I might pick up on one comment, and that is we have already paid for the design work, and I think
right.
The decision about whether we wanted a park or not had to come before that. Mm-hmm. So I think that design work is of no use to me if we don't build a park.
So it might be, yes, Brian.
My son called me today and asked what was going on. I said, talk about this. And he said, oh, Pulaski, that's a crap park. You should fund it. And I thought it made me feel bad to live in a town with a crap park. He used another word, but I'll use crap. It's true. It's a crap park. It really is. For a beautiful town. And I think, Marlene, we all share this huge concern about cost and funding.
Why is this about me?
No, well, I mean, I'm sorry, it's not about you, it's about the park. We all do it. And I think the issue is, our funding this does not mean tax rates will go up or property tax rates will go up. We're not saying, oh, people have to pay additional money for this park. That's not the question. The question is, what are we gonna sacrifice by funding this park? And we're under full realization, if we are funding and if we're bonding, whatever we're doing, it means we will be doing less projects.
Right.
It's not that we're asking people for more money, we aren't. We're simply making a statement that we're going to fund fewer projects. And I think it's a big statement to make, and I'm very supportive of Pulaski. And Glenn, your concerns, I don't think not funding phase two jeopardizes at all phase two. I mean, Jim seemed very confident that it's fine at this point. I mean, he was unequivocal, in my opinion, about that. And if, in fact, we can reduce our bonding by $225,000 and pay that outright without having to bond that, then fiscally, it seems like a responsible thing to do. So I'd be very supportive of the 1.375 funding and hold back on the additional 225.
So that would be, so minus the 225
I have down as 1.375, is that right?
1,450,000, because there is also the additional construction supervision. So I guess at this point we are trying to narrow to a. No, that's what I'm saying. So I'm saying if someone wishes to offer an amendment to the amount, then one could either accept that as a friendly amendment, or we could have a vote on that amendment if not. So does someone want to suggest that, since I have heard from a number of committee members talking about taking out the phase two, it runs up to you as to whether you're going.
Yeah, so I would make an amendment to take out the 225, which leaves us with what again?
1,450,000.
Second.
So that's been accepted as a friendly amendment. So the motion on the table is for 1,450,000. Do we wish to include in the motion that we're making now, we're going to deal with conditions, and which I would also imagine would include our recommendation for bonding. And of course, we recommend bonding, but then the city council, again, they decide if their power to bond. So do we want to include in this motion a recommendation for the term of the bond? So at least that's something that we have in mind going forward, so that we come to the next meeting, we've had 2 weeks to think about the impact of that bonding on our future funding rounds. Or do we want to leave that open?
Well, I've given it some thought, and I think that, you know, 5 years I'm comfortable with. You know, Dave brought in some numbers that reflected 4 years. Three, I think we're affecting ourselves a little bit more. I'd love to get it out of the way in 3 years, but I also think that it is going to affect us a lot more. You know, 2% is a pretty good number, and I don't see that getting any lower, that's for sure. So I was comfortable with 5 years.
Okay, so the motion is now for $1,450,000 to be recommended to City Council with a recommended bond term or recommended debt term of 5 years. So, is there any further discussion?
I just wondered, are there any intermediate options between 5 and 10 years, sir, or is that pretty?
I think those are pretty standard
that you really can't get something in between. Because I'm looking at the amount that a 10-year bond cost is $330,000, which is a huge amount.
We could recommend something in between if that's something the committee's interested in. I could bring in the interim numbers to the next meeting.
If we drop down to the 5 years and pay level principal, that's $330,000 a year. We've already got through other bonding, which is slightly in excess of $200,000, so we've got more than something a little more than half of the CPA funds tied up for the next 5 years.
What are we doing a year, Sarah, for being out at Florence Field?
And it varies by year, so that's bonded out until
2027?
Yeah, fiscal year 27. So it varies by year. Dean Allard in fiscal year 15, interest and principal is $73,838. And then it goes down every year from that.
Sorry, $73,000?
$73,000.
For the year?
For fiscal year 15.
I have a question. So if we recommend $1,450,000, is that what they need during the first phase of the project?
That is the phase one construction of $1,175,000, and that is the budget for the underground utility construction, which is required to get the $400,000 park grant, and that is the $75,000 for the construction services, which is broken into bidding, construction administration,
construction. That's all included?
That's all included in that $1,140,000.
They already have a grant for $400,000. Could we deduct that from the amount since they already have $400,000?
term of park for you?
Yeah, that's been.
It's already been deducted.
Sarah, could you clarify on the bonding? You had circulated before, John Frye had circulated before a chart on the bonding capacity, and it's indicated in FY15, the current bonding obligations are $228,593, which is where I got my number from. I don't know what goes into that, but.
73 might be the interest that goes along with it.
Yeah. So there's Florence Fields in town. So that means available to bond still for fiscal year 16 would be $496,000. And that would be just for that year, so not combined over the 5 years.
Right, but the amount that we have to spend to meet the bonding obligations will be in excess of $500,000. If you combine, if we were to do a 300, whatever it was. If we were to do a 5-year bond payment on this at a cost of $330,000 a year, and then also meet our existing bonding obligations of $200,000+, we'd be in excess, we'd be about $550,000.
No, so we have $492,000 in remaining bonding.
No, I understand, but I'm talking about how much of the available funds the bonding would take, how big a chunk it would take, what would be left over for other projects.
So the fiscal 15 has estimated revenue, local revenue, of $1,060,000. So this is from this latest report. So if it's 550, then there's $450,000 before the state match.
And we'd also be going to FY16. This wouldn't go on to bond before you.
So again, if there's no state match, you're down to $450,000. Per fiscal year, so that's only $225,000 per round. This is the total amount for the fiscal year. So it's a huge, I mean, it's a very large impact. That's the price you pay, I think, for trying to retire quickly.
Right, I know. So that's why I was wondering if there was something in between, maybe, that allows a little bit more room to fund other projects.
Yeah, I don't know that there would be a lot of difference, but I could bring in numbers between 5 and 10.
Do you think there are also the 4 years, the percentage interest?
For 5.
5 years.
If it kicks up to 4% after 5 years, then you're right. That's a cut off.
You could run the calculator, Sarah, if you have internet access. I did that this afternoon to get the 4-year calculation.
5 years is the cutoff, Sarah, on the jump up in the rate?
I believe so, yeah.
Dave, while we're on it, what were your 4 years?
You're going to hit 3% somewhere, so I would imagine, whether that's 7 years.
So I did the calculation at 1.45 instead of 1.5, and I did it at 2% for 3, 4, and 5 years. And they're using the same calculator, which I did with all the same things checked out. And it came out to $502,000 would be the payment, and the interest we owe was $58,000 instead of $60,000 at 3 years. At 4 years, the debt service drops from $502,000 to $380,000, and the interest would be about $73,000-$74,000. 5 years, the debt service dropped to just a little over $300,000, but the interest went up to about $90,000.
What was the 4 year?
4 was right in the middle.
So 75?
It was 380 and 75. It may be worth talking about why we would want to deviate from past practice. I know we've done Forbes at a much larger scale in terms of the number of years. Dean Allard, I think, was a number of years longer. Right?
Forbes
did 12 or 13.
Forbes was 5 years.
Forbes was 5. Forbes was fairly short. Dean Allard was, I think, recommended at 15, but it wasn't out to bond for a couple of years. So it was 13 years.
We ended up doing 12?
Yeah, I mean, to me, it gets to the question of fiscal responsibility, and I feel like this is one of those projects, if it is a centerpiece, and it's something that we're gonna be proud of, it's time to like put our money where our mouth is. And if there's a little hurt that goes along with it, it's a nice reminder that we are paying it down. Doing it over 15 years, I think people lose grasp and accountability and recognition of what we're doing. But I'm also really concerned about it, because Marlene said, and rightly so, we're all taking it in the pocketbook in terms of, you know, our sewer charges, our water charges, our garbage disposal charges, our override and everything else. I'm concerned that at some point we're gonna get another proposal to go from 3% to 1% on CPA or eliminate CPA. And the problem I foresee, although we all have the vote from last time, we retained it with 70%, people saying we want to keep it, is if CPA goes away in 5 years, we continue collecting, even though there's no CPA, we collect until that 15-year bond is paid off, and that seems unfortunate, right? We're getting rid of something that's still on the pay. I'd rather live within the confines of law, live within the confines of what we have, and pay it off and pay it down. And,
do you know who that guy is?
We've had a nice, long, strong, big, fat project for almost 8 years now. And the question is just how aggressive. I kind of like 4 years instead of five, but I can live with five. That's what it takes to push it through. I feel like there's front end and back end costs, right? Front end, you're in that 4 to 5 year period, you may not be able to fund as much, but you're saving a considerable amount of money that could be used in like a year. So I'm not sure where that trade off is between 60,000, 75,000, 90,000. That's not, it might be one or two small projects, but it might be a small project, but it's done in a short amount of time. But we won't have the big dollars in this project. And I'm not sure what the best route is, but I don't feel comfortable going over five.
I think so. It's more responsible to get it over quickly. I think what David said is true. That we would save money if we take the lower interest rate, and that, I would support that if we. The sooner we get it paid off, the better. And I would vote for the system that Devin described, funding in two phases at a very low interest rate. I think that's more responsible.
One way to think about the 5 years is I think we've got a half chance of maybe paying for the phase two instead of bonding.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes me feel better about 5 years. We would not have that possibility if we were willing to 3-year bond. So the interest rate evidently stays the same for a 5-year bond. Of course, you're still paying a little more, but I think that's, we know you're going to pay for interest to take the bond. So that's the only argument I would make for the 5 years, is that I'd have my fingers crossed that we could pay for phase two. And it too will take a park grant, but I think that's the city putting in its effort. And really, if you look at the history of our projects, every phase we do some city projects. So in some ways we're communicating to the city, this is the big project for our near future. So, to catch up on deferred maintenance or to buy a major piece of property won't be in our grasp.
And just to go into the 3 years, I don't know if people are still concentrated on 3 years. And John costed out and he used the 65% of our local match. If we did 3 years, we would see that. So I mean, assuming we're using 65% of our 3 years and then going to do it, it doesn't account for the 10% set aside that we have in each category. We could bump it up for at least this year. I guess we could do it for future years for bottom and say that every time we make the payment on Pulaski Park, we're satisfying either open space or recreation. But that leaves me feeling a little uncomfortable at 3, that we're pushing that far into our local allocation, especially given how dire the state's situation is and how unpredictable our state match.
A motion for 5 years, right?
Yes, I believe it's a motion for 5 years at $1,450,000. So is there any further discussion? Again, understand that we'll come back to conditions.
I'd like to suggest, although this may be to the dismay of people in the audience, that that we reduce that amount somewhat by applying some of this year's funds to that, so the amount that we're bonding is even less. And I would suggest 100,000, like 180.
Comment on that proposal to amend by allocating or recommending an allocation of fund, I guess would be the open space account.
I have difficulty with that without speaking to the other proposals first. So if you want to push that, then we should delay this vote until we have a chance to discuss it. So I feel uncomfortable with that at this point.
I think that's a good idea, to delay this vote until after we listen to the other projects.
Again, just to go over, the mechanism that we have typically used is to go through the proposals and vote them, but the votes are tentative, given the fact that your decision on another fund, you know, the importance of one of the projects we've not considered may lead us to revisit this initial vote. So this is not necessarily set in stone.
I'd be willing to revisit it.
Okay, so definitely at that point we could talk about whether or not or how much we would like to apply if we wanted to apply for what we have currently in our accounts. So
I would like to echo your sentiment that it could be that the process we should use is go through them.
Okay. All right, anything further for this for now, given that it's tentative and we can revisit it later as we finish the round. All in favor of funding this?
Are we considering potential conditions now? Or?
No, this is right now, and just like we'll go through the votes, and then if you want to.
It's a shopping cart thing. We'll be back now.
Yeah. So we have a full meeting for conditions, and again, we want to suggest conditions for people to think about going away as well.
The conditions affect our voting stance. You can change.
Yes. Afterwards. All right, so the motion is for $1,450,000 recommendation to bond for 5 years. All in favor? Okay, that's unanimous. All right, so the next project is the historic Northampton online map. This is a request for $70,000. And would anyone like to begin with a motion?
I move to approve $70,000 for the Northampton Historic Society online map.
Is there a second to that?
No, I'll second.
All right, discussion on.
Well, to get the discussion going, I'll take a slightly less enthusiastic approach. I think it's a wonderful project. I am and I think wonderful efforts have been made to bring an institution back to life and to allow it to continue into the future. I am concerned about that the CPA funds seem to be at this point the primary source of funding for the organization. It's very difficult for a small organization, a small historical organization, a small museum, a small nonprofit, to get ongoing community level support. And there are the stirrings of this now, but I don't think we've seen the reality behind that. And I am concerned about the level of CPA funds that have gone into the organization before they've really been able to show that, yes, this has taken hold and the community is not just excited about the project, which is a wonderful project, but also excited about the organization and willing to commit to and
fund the organization on an ongoing basis, because if we put all this money into it and then the organization falters, you're going to have a website that's not kept up to date, and that pretty soon becomes useless. So I would support some level of funding to assist them in this effort, but not to undertake the entire cost of this. I think there's too many other valuable places that this money has to be.
Comments? Go ahead.
I agree, Linda. I really like the project. I think it's a great idea. I'd like to see some of the research done, almost like a presented to us a cure of 50 properties that we've done research throughout the city, and we need X amount of dollars to get this going, as opposed to building it and then looking to upload it. And while the presentation was great, and I think everyone's excited about the prospect of it, I don't know completely about the functionality of it, and if it's going to do exactly what they want. And it's 1 year that we're paying for a person to build this, and then how are we going to be assured that that's going to be there 2 years down the line, 3 years down the line? $70,000 is a lot of money. So while I do like the project, and I think there could be some money allocated for it, I think I'd rather see some research done in a presentation that shows a little bit more concrete efforts, or a little bit more concrete with how it's going to look and how it's going to hold itself up.
Yeah, I'm pretty much on the same page. The light bulb goes off in my head, and I get excited about connecting with our history, and I feel like it is a missing link. And the idea of doing it through social media and something that's much more accessible, you don't have to be in a musty file, is exciting. But I feel like I would much rather be wholly enthusiastic around, like, this is a project that is going to bear its fruit. And I feel like there was a lot of ambiguity in the application and the presentation about we don't know which vehicle we're going to use, we're not sure which site we're going to use, different things on its merit. That, to me, does not inspire a lot of confidence when it's the first year to get the program up and running. And I understand there's a need for research, but research in and of itself is not the preservation of the history. It's taking that, as Glenn said, and putting it into the usable format and preserving it. That's truly important. And I think the other part that concerns me, in addition to what Linda said about, you know, we've already given some money, I'd like to see where that goes and make sure that the organization is capable. I'm more concerned about kind of the overarching, we want to encompass everything in this current project. I feel like there are probably historical events in different places that warrant the potential of a researcher, and to get that stuff incorporated. I'm not sure that using CPA funds to document, like, a house like mine that was built in 1988 helps us with our historic mission. I understand history is always evolving, but that isn't, for me, what I want to be recording. I also have some concern about, you know, that part of the application is going to, you know, probate court and posting all the wills for every house in Northampton. Those are extremely personal things to the families, and they reveal personal history that not everyone wants exposed. And so I would like to see a much more targeted approach as to what it is about our history that we want to cover. And again, I think the word is really concrete. I would love to be in full support and give the money to something that I feel will work, as opposed to something that I have just concerns about at this point. So, yeah, if we go back and help done with the project, if we can give some guidance as to how to make it more competitive in the future, I think that's great.
Other comments?
I think you all made really good concrete points, and I think I have a concern about partially funding, as I don't know what they would do with partial funding, and part of what I heard was to scale back the technology, and I just think that creates something that nobody wants. So that would be my concern for partial funding. I like your idea that we could work with them to support a stronger application.
Glenn sort of discussed something on the order of a pilot project, where we, and it might answer Dave's concern about the types of information that are going to be put into the system that we would all be interested in.
Is that the kind of partial that concerns you, or is just, does putting that flavor on it make it feel like then when we came back to look at it again, we'd be in a good position to say it had proven its merit?
The partial is really based on what we heard during the presentation, that if they didn't have enough money to go on with the technology, which I don't think would be interesting, very many people come back to it. The idea is a great idea, and it's what we need to get there, because 5 years from now, even that would be a problem. So that's really my concern. I don't know if they're going to do pilots.
Other comment?
I feel like we fund it or we don't. I mean, I don't, people have expressed, understand what partial funding would bring. A half-time person, half of the equipment, I don't get it. They would have to come back for that. And the thing that concerns me the most is the continuity. It's a year project and then what? They're on the teetering on the brink of financial chaos as it is, and we're literally propping up the buildings to try to keep them afloat. We're putting something like this where after a year it could crash and burn, and I'm not sure this is the time for this. On the other hand, to keep the Historic Northampton relevant, this is a wonderful thing, but I think we should request that they come back with another proposal that is much more targeted and that it's not quite as ambitious and maybe extends over a couple of years rather than years.
I was pretty pleased with the quality of the proposal, I mean, particularly compared to some of the others we've gotten. So I don't know that I want to indicate that we just don't know enough about it. I think there are characteristics of it that you all are vitally concerned about, you know, what happens to the organization. But I do think that you're concerned about how does the town step up and support. I mean, the story in the paper was pretty compelling. We need the visibility and we need something to get excited about. So I heard that. That's why I wondered if there was a way to take just a small piece of real estate. I don't know how I would come to that decision on where to start, but maybe the commercial buildings downtown that are in central business district, and we look at who's lived there previously and begin to document those.
But isn't that asking them to come back again? I brought up 50 properties. 50 is probably a big number. They did 20 or 25 and said, this is what we want to do. And this is the information that's going to be input, and this is the engine, or the, you know, the engine that's going, we're going to use to share it with everyone. I just think there's a lot of gray when it comes to how that's going to be. I know that they have volunteers for research, but get the research, show us what it is, and then let's build it.
Danny, may I answer any of the questions that were raised or not?
At this point, it's really for the committee to act on the information, because we really want to give, you know, have every applicant stand in the same position. So if we were gathering information from you at this point, then it would be
there are new donations that I thought would address Linda's question.
So I guess we need the information. At some point, we need to close the information that we're taking in. Otherwise, again, we don't want to have some applicants be able to present at this point and others not. So my concern is just with websites is that even very good websites become obsolete very quickly. The technology is always moving forward. So what seemed like great dynamic content and worked perfectly on this year's browser within a year, 2 years, may not work as well or may be supplanted. So when I looked at the budget, one thing that struck me really was the fact that it's to get it up and running, and it's actually not even, one of the things is, it seemed like the employee was more doing content, like content acquisition. There wasn't a budget for somebody to run a website. And so when the server goes down, something crashes and you need someone to bring that back up. And it wasn't clear to me whether that was going to be a server, you know, hosted by someone else or whether the server was going to be there. But that's another significant cost. Again, I'm not sure if you award partial funding, then you get a design You know, I think if you do 50 prod, you know, 50, if you do 50 houses, that might affect the employee who's doing the research and uploading of the documents. But the design, if you get an architect to design a shed, then you can't say, oh, now I have the money for the house. I mean, it's like they're going to give you a design for a shed, they're going to give you a design for a lower cost, less capable website. And I'm not sure when they come back in whether they can necessarily roll that content into one that's more scalable. But maybe not. Maybe because it's based on GIS layers, they couldn't do that. So so I have a lot of the concerns that I heard from the committee. So we have a motion for full funding, and we've heard thoughts about partial. We've heard thoughts about looking to another application. So are there any further comments before we take a vote? So all in favor of funding the Northampton, historic Northampton on light site, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, opposed? Abstain? Okay, so the motion does not pass, so we move on to the next proposal. Which is the Seth Thomas clock restoration. It's a request from the Office of Planning and Sustainability for $32,000. Is there a motion?
We have to have a start. I move we approve the restoration of the Seth clock for $32,000.
Okay, is there a second?
Second.
All right, discussion on this proposal.
We bought the clock, so my first question is, can't we just put the clock somewhere until we need it?
Yeah, can we wait? That was my thing. I want it too. if they want to put it near the park, that park's not going to be ready for a clock for quite some time.
Was there a time element in regard to this repair?
Not that I heard.
Is it a year? Is it ridiculously long? I mean,
$32,000
is a lot of money.
There was no targeted, consultant selection can be started when it's awarded. So they haven't even come up with that. So
I don't think the huge pool of people that stand to do the work, but
I would assume so.
Unless the last Seth Thomas replacement parts are sent to someone else. So the warehouse is empty.
Well, I mean, and I don't know that we've got a great place to store it, but I mean, I think somewhere will be found. Not undoable, and I think we ought to fund enough to move it to where it needs to go. And it seems kind of obvious we just wait until that.
Was that part of the application to move it?
Well, if they're going to restore it, somebody, you're going to pay a restorer, and the restorer is going to come get it and take it and fix it and then put it on location, is what I assumed from the way the application was written. So if we don't fund the restorer, I think we still have to get the clock out of its location in West Springfield, Holyoke.
You might have to file an application when you do that, don't
they? You said that DPW was evaluating whether or not they would be able to do that.
Yeah, there's possible options, but the city's not sure if we'll be able to store it within the city for no charge at this point. So we may have to pay to have it stored somewhere.
My other thought on the clock, I know that we talked about this when we talked about the purchase of it, but this seems to be one of those things that would be appropriate for fundraising or some kind of match. So in addition to the time issue, you know, you harken back to the movie Back to the Future when their town clock stopped, and that was the premise of the movie. Fundraising for that, it just seems like the focal point that can draw some ownership in Pulaski Park. You know, I'd like to see some kind of effort in that regard, but at this point, I feel like I would much rather pay down the debt on Pulaski Park or other projects than on the clock, because it's not.
I'm swayed by that argument if we hadn't already bought the clock. I don't want to waste that money.
So no, I'm talking about the restoration.
Okay, but then what do we, how do we manage?
Do we need to appropriate some money to, in, you know, say just $5,000 in case there's cost to move it or to store it? Do we have to do that?
I have a question. I mean, didn't it stand down right across from facilities for years? Why don't we just stored there.
On the sidewalk?
Where it used to be forever.
I haven't seen what kind of streets it's in, but I don't know.
That is to, I mean, that is to be the site that's been suggested is Pulaski Park. However, it was to be in a prominent location. That was the condition.
So why can't we store it if it's an outside clock? Why is it so different to store?
Because they're pieces, it's in pieces.
Oh, it's in pieces now, okay.
It's not.
I would suggest we nominate David, who's not here, to be chair of Seth Thomas Clock Restoration Fundraiser Committee. And he can come up with a 32,000. So I can't believe we don't have a place in all of town hall that we can't store. It's not that huge a thing. What is it, 8 foot?
The basement's too damp.
And the weight.
Yeah, and we couldn't put it on an upper floor because it's so big.
So the project budget, so if we're looking to do this within the current application, the project budget for this restoration application does say the project will include an estimated $10,000 in storage and movement costs. So we could, within this, they wouldn't have to make another application. Within this application, it was anticipated as a potential storage and movement cost. So again, 12 o'clock, we have no place to this.
A motion to...
Well, again, I don't know what the... Sarah, can you tell us the condition of the transaction? I mean, it is currently in storage. When is it to be...
That, I don't know. I don't know the kind of detail.
Yeah, I didn't think that we're paying for storage now. We bought it.
We didn't move it.
But we have to get it out.
So it wouldn't surprise me if there's a bill that goes along with from the time that we bought it. So where we look high here with...
I'll store my living room for $3,000.
$2,000. You're storing your basement very quickly.
Danny, I'm not sure if I'm understanding what you just said. So I'm looking at where it says project budget, and it says the entirety of CPA funds will be used for restoration of the clock. The estimate attached establishes a cost of between $25,000 and $35,000, and the project will also include an estimated, the CPA project, $10,000. And then it does say the Office of Planning and Sustainability will conduct a fundraising campaign for the clocks for repair, which will be used as a match. We also plan to use donated DPW labor for installation.
So that's, I mean, their total budget for the project was $38,000. So that included both the restoration as well as the storage and the donation of labor. So again, difficulty is coming up with a number to free the clock. So do we wish to defer this until we get information from Planning Sustainability about what amount is adequate to that?
To do what?
Well, what amount is, so we don't know. We know that there's an estimate of $10,000. We don't know what it's costing right now. We certainly, if it would cost us $5,000 to store the clock where it is right now, we wouldn't want to appropriate $10,000 to move it to a new place, especially since it's going to eventually have to be moved again to the stores. So I'm just wondering if we can get, could make a condition that, or we could condition it that they use the minimum amount of money, but I don't know that we have. Or we can appropriate an amount again, since we have the $10,000, we can appropriate part of the $10,000, and the city can come up with the additional money.
I'd like to request the city lets us know what city properties they've investigated for potential storage. There's been an incentive to try to find a free place to put it as opposed to saying, we're going to cover your storage costs and moving costs from the get-go. Mm-hmm. We've always said this, we're going to put it in City Hall, and we've got school properties and DPW properties and all our other properties that might be around it, and they have to at least know what to go with that before showing up.
Sarah, that's reasonable?
Yeah, that should be fine.
In a couple weeks?
Yeah.
All right, so then we're going to postpone that until we have information about the minimum amount of money, or again, we could vote now, again, since our vote would tentatively affect other amounts that we're planning to spend, and then with that information, we could withdraw that money and reallocate.
I mean, I'm okay allocating $10,000 to keep.
My concern is
some,
that
we have some skin in the game here, right?
But that becomes an extra $10,000 unless the city has a plan for, you know, we're going to spend that $10,000 paying for it to stay where it is what's going to happen.
Are we?
I don't
we
know.
Don't know.
That's
okay.
What we're saying.
Okay. So the deferred probably.
Yeah.
Okay. So we will defer that.
But as a part of the process, though, if, just for us to keep in mind, if we did not fund the historic Northampton and we've decided to bond the city park, we are in an amount of money that will cover the projects that we're talking about now. So I know there's a point of discussion of how much of that do we put against the park, but I just wanted to say we're in that ballpark now.
No, well, not really. We're specific. We still have 300 something thousand proposals with 180 to spend. We have 200,000 for the jail, we have 50 for the. That's 280,000.
I think that just as many questions about this clock as there are about the website. So I feel fine just putting it off and having the city come back with some information. I think they have just as much of a duty to plan as does the historical application. So. Ask them to be more specific about why and where and what they want the money for.
Can you just clarify why the city gets more time to explain what they're doing and we're not giving that to
start? I think the difference is that we own the clock and I don't want to spend more money. I mean, again, we could just say, too bad for the city, we're not giving them any money, mm-hmm. and that they then have to appropriate money from the budget to make the clock transport. The problem is if they can't do that, the clock remains where it is. That's why I want the information as to when we actually have to take possession of the clock. I'm hoping that we can, and as you know, Dave's question, I'm hoping that we can minimize the amount of money. And I guess the difference is that we've already appropriated money, so I'm just trying not to have a problem. And I think the committee's trying to minimize follow-on costs. But again, if it is up to the applicant to make all the information available, and they have it. So if they don't give us an adequate, you know, there's no adequate answer to that. Basically, they will have to come up with a solution to have the clock in Holyoke on the place to put it. All right, so we will move on to the Broadbrook Greenway acquisition. Is there a motion to fund this?
Yes, so full funding.
Is there a second?
Second.
All right, discussion.
So, you know, going on Boggy Meadow Road is a huge access route for so many people. It's, I think, as was noted in the application, it's a very ecologically sensitive piece of land, but also it's very important for access. Because it borders Boggy Meadow Road, the beavers are a problem. Invasive species coming in or resource extraction. $30,000 seems a very reasonable amount. I think all of us agree that Broadbrook is a crown jewel of Northampton Conservation Area and is so widely used by so many people. And the trail there that borders on that now private land, put that in the public land, I think is a wonderful chance again for us to expand this marvelous piece of property that we have. And BBC Broadbrook, you know, talk about a great public-private partnership, and they're the ones maintaining it. They've done such a wonderful job in all of the work that they do. We had both the chair, I think the vice chair, speak to that. So I would fully support the $30,000.
Other comment?
The
totally agree.
It's another acquisition. I just don't see, between this and other priority parcels that come before us in urgency with this one, that couldn't wait to another round. I feel like with the minimal amount that we have, again, I'd rather pay down the debt on Pulaski Park and spend the money. Part of me feels that funding the conservation fund partially is a better investment in terms of the conservation for the coming year than purchasing this particular parcel, which could come in future rounds. Whereas we don't fund conservation fund or we don't fund it as much, we're losing out on lots of little potential acquisitions.
Sarah, can you clarify that for us? The option has been signed, and that runs out at some point.
Yeah, the option, the commitment is, the commitment from the city to purchase is due 9/30/15 with the closing by October 31st. So that's the current option.
So that option would then run out before we had a chance to fund this for the next cycle.
Yeah, because
they can also extend the option to do that. I mean, I don't know if it's guaranteed, but it also didn't sound like there was development pressure in getting 90% wetlands. We asked Wayne where that development pocket was, and it wasn't the most convincing argument to me that would be, unlike some of the other parcels, where you have the long driveway and it's, and be subdivided. This one didn't speak to me the same way. Is there potential that we lose it? I'm not sure what the potential consequences are, aside from the beaver dam. And if that's really important, then down it's important for you and the Concom should have that.
Looking at this parcel, a good amount of it is would be protected because it would be within the 50-foot, basically no disturbed zone or protected zone around the wetlands, and as well within 200 feet of a perennial stream. There's also protection from the Riverfront Protection Act. The only thing that it doesn't protect it from is logging, and so logging has broad exemption from wetlands protection. And so, it's often parcels that you think of as fairly well protected are heavily impacted by logging. And we as a conservation commission have zero ability to review that. They don't even have, they show us a copy, but they usually DCR will ask for our comments, but the logging a lot of times is already underway. So that would be my only concern is that this parcel is swamp forest, and if there are trees worth taking out, that again, the logging plan, when you go in during the winter to minimize damage, but you're not going to get no damage. And also, if you do a cut, you're going to potentially release invasives that have accumulated there. That if you have any, it's clearly been logged within not too long a period. I think this particular parcel is in terms of urgency, I think that adding, it just makes sense to add contiguous parcels to existing conservation areas. It makes a lot of sense to me. And so from that, the Hanson Porch Forest Legacy parcel that was added was in the same area. So this is sort of, again, creating a buffer to development to the south. So for that reason, I think it's worth adding. Also, in terms of the timing, with the closing happening by 10/31/15, that does allow you additional time, actually, for local tax receipts to accumulate. So our fiscal position won't be exactly the same if we're taking in $70,000 a month in local receipts. We should be able to, at that point, absorb this $30,000 and perhaps absorb what we might appropriate for the conservation fund.
Is there any active beaver management on that person?
Well, with beaver management, the city has the power to enter on private land if there's going to be harm to humans, either human life and safety or human property. And they have done that before. again, when that happens, it's an emergency situation. It's not necessarily the best from an ecological standpoint, because usually the dam will be breached, and then the pool will drain pretty rapidly, which, you know, beaver ponds are, and again, this has been consistent with the Conservation Commission and BBC's mode of operating. Beaver ponds are great. Beaver ponds are creation of the, you know, the best habitat in terms of creating, you know, really rich wetlands with a lot of species that are there. So if the property is acquired, then that means the Conservation Commission gets to decide how to manage it in a way that's most consistent with maintaining that new ecosystem. If it's not, then when it builds up to the point that when the dam breaks, it's going to damage property downstream, DPW would just go with the backhoe. And again, at that point, the Conservation Commission has no power to review that. It's an emergency order for that situation.
Does the CONCOM have any preliminary discussion with the type of management that we want to have on this front?
You know, again, I was at the dam shortly after it was constructed. Have you, Sarah, talked to? One of the things with beaver deceivers is whether or not you have enough drop for them to work, and whether or not if there are too many roots, it might be hard to position. But I would think a beaver deceiver would be something that might work in that location. It's not a huge dam. It was on the order of 2 to 3 feet high at that point. So, but again, absent purchasing it, it's on private property. You don't have any power to. And that's been an issue actually for the Conservation Commission in Barrett Street Marsh. We put beaver deceivers in Barrett Street Marsh that we owned, but then when the problem jumped across the bike path onto private property, which the city had made efforts to acquire, it became much more difficult because it was on private property. And so, and as a result, the problem wasn't cured, and then it actually ended up doing more harm because it wasn't cured, so it then overflowed and ran down State Street. So.
And do you think this parcel affords sufficient depth to manage the beavers without that happening?
Yes. I mean, it's the boggy meadow. I mean, it's been boggy for a long time, so it's very flat. The amazing thing is that when the beavers brought the water level up by 6 to 8 inches, it inundated as far as the eye could see. So again, that's a lot of area that you could, you know, potentially absorb increases in water level, but while trying to keep it below the road level.
And is $1,000 market price for largely flatland that's undeveloped?
Again, you know, it would be possible to negotiate a lower price for that. Again, if you say this is not land that you're going to be able to develop very easily. My guess is that's a fair price, because again, the city can't pay more than the assessed price for the land, and they might be able to carve off some lots that are farther enough away from the river and that are actually wet. So again, I trust Wayne's judgment in terms of having purchase land that he wouldn't just decide to spend this money because he knows that this money is money that won't necessarily become available. We on the Conservation Commission know that money that's, if you overspend on one parcel, that's money that's taken away from the next purchase.
You can go home anytime you want.
So any additional comments? All right, hearing none, all in favor, say aye.
Aye. Okay.
That's unanimous. All right, the next is the Conservation Fund. The request is for $50,000. This is for soft costs associated with acquisition of property, as well as less than $20,000 hard costs without approval from the committee. And if it was more than $20,000, it would be with our approval for hard costs for purchase price. So is there a motion?
I would make a motion to fund at half the request of $25,000. I think Wayne indicated that would be appropriate for a year.
Second.
And can I ask one question, Sarah? So the Conservation Commission Conservation Fund at this point is zero, correct?
It is, let's see. So there is $10,000 in the ACE Conservation Fund, and Wayne indicated that all of that is a work with the depending project.
I'm sorry, all that is committed?
Depending project, yeah.
Okay, so essentially it's zero.
So it is zero. My number was gonna be $20,000, and that's because it's the cutoff, it's because I think that'll get Wayne through to the next funding cycle. It's really no more defensible than picking half, but it's $5,000 less, and I think we do need to fund that pot of money to work with. We've gotten good results out of it, but I think the number we get funded a lot.
So $20,000 is their additional carbon. All right, hearing none, all in favor? All right, good. Unanimous. $20,000. All right. The last project to consider is the Union Street Jail staircase restoration. It's a request for $200,000. Is there a motion?
Sure, I'll move to fund it at 20,000.
All right, is there a second? Motion second at $20,000. Discussion on this project.
Well, I guess I can say, with as many comments as I had in support of the Boston Park, I had as many that were against funding this particular project. And while very empathetic to condo association and the situation that they're in, it's just not public enough space. Really make me feel good and understand that this is the business you can run. I wanted to see it get fixed. I just don't think it's the CPA's responsibility to do it.
I was very concerned about the $200,000 and there needs to be a whole lot of public purpose behind it for the $200,000, and I do think that's lacking. On the other hand, I do think that it is a very important structure. I think the stairs are an integral part of its presentation, its public face. I am very impressed with what the current condo association is doing to try to preserve this building. Clearly, mistakes were made. They were very forthright about that, and now they are trying, I think, to operate in a very responsible manner and to preserve this, and I would like to support them in, because I do, it's quite credible to me that they have very limited ability to do it on their own, and I would like to lend some support, but given that it is mostly a visual contribution to the public and to the sense of Northampton and its history. I just can't see being the primary funder behind it. I don't know if that means it is an impossibility for them, and I would need to ensure that there was some kind of a preservation restriction, which might be more burden than benefit for the money. The get out of it is the face of this preserved for the future.
Where do you come up with 20,000?
Out of nowhere. Out of some recognition of what they're attempting to do with the preserve or something that is, I think does have some importance to.
So, I mean, I have great admiration for the condo association. It's an incredibly important historic building. I think we funded it in full. We have, I think there are 27 units there. We'd have 27 very happy people, and we'd have 27,000 very unhappy people. And while respectful minority rights, I'm going to go with the 27,000 on this. It is, you know, there's no public use of the building. I think we set a very interesting precedent for private, public funding and private ownership. My heart goes out to the condo association. I think they've done a great job. It's a wonderful proposal. It's just not CPA worthy. I don't think it's $20,000 CPA worthy. I just don't see it here. I think it's a, you know, I just don't see it.
I feel similarly in many respects to what folks have said. I mean, I wanted to dispel the myth that CPA funds can't be used on private buildings. I mean, the purpose is historic preservation, so if it's a question of who should be funding the condo association, that's not really the question. One aspect is what's the historic nature. Another aspect is what's the public's appreciation of that. How do those two things merge together? Another aspect is how does it compare to other projects in this round? What do we do with the limited amount of money that we have? And I think that that's the perfect storm, one of the reasons why we're seeing this reaction. I also feel like a number of our historic properties have the same story, whether it's private or public, is we have mismanagement or poor management or set of circumstances that have led to neglect. And not one who likes to fund benign, in fact, we have definitions in our CPA statutes that say that's exactly what we should be doing for rehabilitation. So for that reason, I think it has merits. I think it's a difficult one here. I think my comfort level would be more akin to what we did, although I had some problems with it, over at the fairgrounds where we said, you want to do a study to see how you want to refurbish your grandstand. That was for repurposing. Here it's already been repurposed. And there's an element of this proposal that talks about, let's take an assessment of our historic property period and see what needs to be done. I think in my mind, I'd be more inclined to fund that aspect so that the condo association could have some sense about what reserves it needed and to prioritize its work, whether it's stairs or something else that might be more pressing than the stairs. But at this juncture, with everything else we have on the table, I don't feel comfortable funding at $200,000. Even if we were to fund at $200,000, we'd have to bond for a portion of it. And that makes it even more unpalatable if you're looking at the 27 versus 27,000. And I think the other aspect is, you know, maybe this is a proposal that, although it was great on its face, can be improved so that maybe it satisfies more of our criteria in terms of public access or public messaging or the importance of the jail or how to merge those concepts together so it's not people appreciating from afar when they're walking by at a distance as opposed to coming in, you know, that way there's some synergy. So I think this is another one of those applications that maybe we can work with the applicant potentially, or as Linda said, maybe fund a portion.
So I agree with Dave that it's clear that the CPA, that it's appropriate for CPA to fund the preservation of private property. We've done it before. So the Grove Street Church, First Churches, and it's just going to be true that many historic structures are going to be in private hands. And that may, you know, again, the Pomeroy Terrace, to the extent we're helping Pomeroy Terrace to be designated, that will then perhaps allow those homeowners who are private homeowners to get government funding to help preserve the facades, or, you know, get lower interest loans to preserve the facades of their homes. So, you know, clearly the government, at the federal level, recognizes that giving people incentives to preserve what are private homes is important. At the same time, we've also said no to homeowners and who have come to us before. We've even said no to Forest Library when they came for, you know, a project to change all the windows in the building. And that, again, is a building that's exclusively for public use. So I guess here that the context, and again, as Dave said, working with the applicant to come up with a way to help you know, see how this building will connect, be more connected to the community. And that's, it's a difficult balance because it's private property and it's private homes. But one of the things when we did fund, or at least partially fund the restoration of the steps of the courthouse, was one of the things that the Community Preservation Committee and the community got out of that was that the area around the courthouse, which was completely unprotected at that point, and so if the state decided they wanted to come in, since they hold title to the property, and build a new modern building that went right to the sidewalk, they could have done it. And the city would have lost what we take for granted as public green space. And so there's now a permanent conservation restriction on that space. So again, you know, that was important to me as in terms of, you know, giving something and making sure the community maintains something in terms of, because again, those steps are beautiful, but you can't go in the door because of security concerns for the courthouse that's at the other end. So it's a, you know, beautiful staircase, but non-functional door. So again, I would look, you know, forward to, you know, potentially, again, talking about maybe a smaller grant that is assisting in design or assisting in trying to find a solution that might work, because I think that we all recognize that this is an important historic asset. So with that said, is there any other comment? All right, hearing none, all in favor of funding the proposal at $20,000, say aye. Opposed? Abstained? Okay. All right, so that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7 voting against and 1 abstaining. All right, so it's relatively early, and so what I have is $30,000 from the Broadbrook Greenway acquisition, $20,000 from the Conservation Fund, $1,450,000 for Pulaski Park. Those are the funding amounts. We're still discussing the minimum appropriation, the minimum recommendation to either prevent damage to the clock or to minimize the cost of storing the clock going forward until such time as it can be restored. So that's what we're trying to get a handle on for that. So at this point, are there any conditions that people would like to suggest that we would attach to these recommendations? While we're here and it's relatively early, I think we have, you know, Broadbrook, that acquisition, and the Conservation Fund. We could at least try to deal with those, and then we can at least begin the discussion of what might be appropriate conditions for Pulaski Park.
Before we do that, could we revisit, or are we holding that for next time?
No, we can certainly. Yeah, we'd like to revisit the funding out.
If we preserve a potential $10,000 for the Seth Thomas clock,
right,
that would allow about $120,000 to $125,000 to be committed to Pulaski Park.
Absolutely. So the motion is with $185,000 currently available in this round, that taking out $60,000 for the conservation fund, the greenway, and the reserve, potential reserve for the clock shipping and handling, that we appropriate recommend appropriation of $125,000. Which would reduce the bond amount to $1,325,000. So is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Second.
Any second discussion?
It's an appealing idea, but I'm still concerned that this conversation about $10,000 for the clock will end up being an extra 10. And so, it's a number given in the restoration contract, but if you separate it from restoration, is there still not 32 or whatever the number is? So I think I'd like to know, I'm wanting to know what we're going to do with the clock before I make up my mind. I would restore the clock now if I thought that the $10,000 to store it came on top of the restoration project. So, because we could. And I think we've already bought the clock, and so we're going to do it now or we're going to do it later. And so if the storage between now and later makes that ticket item higher, I don't think we're saving very much. So I've got an unknown there, and I'm disappointed we don't know, because it's a city answer. We should have that.
Poor application. We don't know.
Whatever balance remains after the determination on September. Thank you.
So when do we give recommendations to City Council? When would they be voting for the first?
May. So we have our next meeting. We have our next meeting on April 22nd. And so it would be the May next meeting. It would be taken. So there's...
The 22nd or the 15th?
No, we're not having a meeting next week.
But next week is the 8th.
The 15th is school vacation week.
So we skipped over to the 22nd.
So it would be for the May 1st.
Yeah.
Well, the city council.
No, the May 1st city council.
Yeah.
Not only this last year.
David. I just want to make sure that it's before and I agree with the idea. Taking whatever remainder we have and applying it to our debt here. But I also want to make sure that Sarah and John have the necessary tools to assist us moving forward. So do we have a reserved amount for CPC operations that covers your expenses?
Yeah, so that's set aside at the beginning of the year,
right.
Along with the
Do you feel that's sufficient given the state of your and John's computers and access and anything that we may need?
Yeah, we don't have any outstanding admin things that we see, but we typically return half of that.
That's usually fine. We can even take more of that.
So that will come back to the CPC at the end of the fiscal year.
Right.
What's up with computer here, sir?
That works. I did. I have a computer. This works. I guess it would work.
All right. So the motion. As amended by the motion, is that we would commit when we get the final answer with regards to the clock, and again we're trying to minimize expenditure on that we commit the balance of available funds to reduce the amount that we have to be funded. So is there further discussion on that excellent motion?
I just have a question. Who's managing the clock? Who's in charge of the clock? We don't seem to really
know. The DPW is, as far as I know, managing physical custody of the clock.
Okay.
So. And we were assured the DPW would take, yes, not only would they wind it, but also they would, more importantly, take excellent care so they would not be damaged further. So, any other comment or discussion? All in favor of that motion, say aye. Okay, that's unanimous. So now we're back to conditions.
Is there anything on Broadbrook that would be important, either for access or if you want to have a picture of you for them?
You know, I think that. Again, this would be managed as part of the Broadbrook Greenway by DBC, and I think that DBC has done an excellent job in the past in terms of managing food impacts, and they've always, they always work closely with the Conservation Commission. So when a new deceiver needs to go in or when a level needs to be adjusted, it's not, they don't just say, oh, we're just going to hire someone to do it for the Conservation Commission. So I can't think of a reason for attaching that particular condition, which has worked pretty well in the past.
Anything about the road that goes back to the...
You know, one of my concerns was that it sounded from Wayne's presentation that the solution would be to, if the beavers continue to raise the level, and you couldn't make the case that you should go on the property because there was a hazard, because that brook was going to flow downstream and damage property, that the solution would be, well, let's put another 6 inches of trap rock gravel on it. Which, you know,
that didn't sound good to you?
No. I mean, because again, the marsh, the actual swamp, it extends on both sides of the road. It used to exist. Now it has to go through culverts. So
what was the other solution? That was to rewrap to access.
Well, the other solution is the investigation of the access from Rift Drive. So
which is a Fitzgerald.
Which was the Fitzgerald property, which was an informal trail for a long time until it was closed off. But the city had a right to access the dam from Rift Drive until such time as they had other means of accessing the dam. So the open question for the solicitor, which I don't know the current answer, is if the beavers inundated that road and it went away, Volumetal Road went away, and you had to wear your rubber boots to get through there, you know, if you wanted to get to get across that area, whether or not that would then recreate the right or renew the right to enter through Rift Drive. So we just didn't know whether when that right went away forever, or whether it could come back. So that was open. It's a good property exam question. So
do you see a condition of not increasing the height of the road? Is that what?
Well, the problem is that if you need to get to the dam, you need to be able to get, you need to be able to mow the dam. Otherwise, obviously, dam safety, you know, I mean, the dam will have trees growing in it and it won't function. Right. So the DPW needs, or you know, Conservation Commission has had farmers doing it in trade. So you need access some way. So if it became impassable, they would need to do that. Unless they could find a way for a drive. So I can't think of anything around that.
Do we usually put that condition in that the conservation restriction is transferred to, is it Kestrel or?
We do, yeah. Well, not, we don't specify who, just because
we just say the conservation. Depends. Someone else, a third party will hold the conservation.
So in this case, yes. So, well, in this case, this is the conservation. This is not a conservation restriction. Are we going to make, we're doing that now?
We have to.
Yeah.
And BBC won't hold. Yeah. BBC will not.
Well, BBC does hold some conservation.
They're out of the CR hold.
They got out of the CR hold. Okay. All right. So I don't see any with that. Any for the conservation fund?
It's the same typical one.
It's right. It's already written that it's. Right, the limit of $20,000 hard costs to government. If they go over that, they have to have approval, and soft costs are not restricted. So of course, since there's only $20,000 in the fund, I guess that won't be coming to us for approval. So now we come to Pulaski Park. So potential conditions.
Condition that the CPA funds are not used for the purchase, transport, or planting of the large evergreen intended to replace the current holiday tree.
Okay.
And by doing so, they can still use the park grant to do it, and they could fundraise for it. So, even trade just means that our funds would be useful.
I propose a condition that the tree stays. Surprise, surprise.
Wow.
Before the Christmas tree.
propose a condition that the tree stay alive.
So, well, let's take them in order. I'm sympathetic with Dave that it's clear that the tree is not just a tree, and that it's I think it's a holiday tree now, but it's decorated around that holiday, and you know, I'm not even sure, especially since it's one specific pine tree. It's not even a grove of pines, but we're cutting down one tree and replacing it with one other tree. So I'm probably more than other people a little bit leery of mixing church and state, especially because on school committee, I feel that sometimes that same sort of thing still happens, and I'm sensitive to the fact that we do sometimes there are certain religions that we make room for because they're majority religions, and there are certain religions that we don't. And I don't know if, you know, I don't know whether we would have to, if we had that holiday tree, whether we would have to have other kind of holiday displays. Now again, I think that in terms of law, you're probably okay with the holiday tree. But I think what Dave's recognizing is that there are some people in the community who might be uncomfortable, and for the Community Preservation Committee, where do we want to come down as far as, again, what's a relatively, this is a $22,000 tree in a $1.5 million park. And since we already know that perhaps to avoid the entanglement of the city being involved in lighting the holiday tree, that the I think the fact that there's private fundraising to light the tree is itself an implicit recognition that this is not just a, right, this is not just a holiday lighting that's not tied to something that is religious. So.
Well, that's another reason to not take the tree down. It's because of all this controversy, we're not going to have a tree downtown.
Well, yeah, I mean, potentially if it's not funded, but Glenn.
So while I respect both of your positions, I believe the tree represents more the retail aspect of the holiday than the religious aspect of the holiday. There's Santa Claus with a fire truck.
Right.
There's no nativity scene. Jesus isn't mentioned. I think it was a big deal when they said they were going to cut it down. I think a lot of people were really upset by that. So yeah. I think the happy medium was to replace it and put it, you know, a full-grown evergreen tree is a big deal. 20-foot evergreen tree is a big deal. And so they made the extent, you know, they went to the extent of putting it in another important part of the park. And if and when that tree is lit during the holiday season, people will enjoy it. My guess is that most of the people that enjoy that tree when it's lit around that holiday season don't go to church. I think it's part of what the downtown atmosphere is, and I think that any business owner downtown is going to say, if there's something else that can make our downtown more vibrant, more inviting, more enjoyable during the holiday season, they're all for it. So,
well said. I agree with him 100%. Yeah, it's just the mood. To me, it's not all these lights hung on the street and the wreaths and the banners. It's, that tree really sets the mood. And I'm not a religious person, but I love that tree, especially when it's lit up around Christmas time. It's the mood, the shopping mood. That, I don't think it's a religious symbol. It isn't to me either. Christmas is just a big retail time. It's a shopping time.
Christmas trees are not religious.
No. Yeah, what is
the,
how is that connected with religion? I don't get
it. This is where we went, though. I mean, this is my point. And again, I think us, after all the discussion that went into that tree, mm-hmm. us taking a stance saying,
yeah.
we don't feel as though that public input was as important as the rest of the project. So you guys go fund it.
Yeah, it's mentioned like three times in the notes that I read. the tree. A lot of people said, oh, a lot of people are going to be upset about taking that tree
down. It's okay to make a statement in regard to it. I'm not in favor of not funding it.
I mean, again, not let other people speak, but it's curious to me that this Friday there's a half day in the Northampton Public Schools. And yet we have, right, and we don't officially, right, we don't officially recognize Good Friday anymore, but yet it's still there in the calendar. And so for those members of that religious community, even though it's not explicitly recognized, it works with their religious observances. And I guess saying that, you know, when you say that a Christmas tree is not religious, to me, that shows how dominant. I mean, I was raised Catholic, so all the, you know, Christmas, it is the dominant paradigm. And so to suggest that you would do something different seems artificial. That seems like a major change. But I just think in recognition of that we're putting a permanent, you know, permanent feature and significant space in the park for what I think is, you know, it's not a crash, it's not a manger, but it is associated with, you know, a holiday season that's not centered around any other major religion. It's centered around Christmas, which again has become a commercial exercise. And I see, you know, I agree with your logic that now it's, if it can drive business, that's fine. But this, you know, we are spending public money. And, you know, if you said, can we spend public money to advertise Christmas sales downtown, I think there might be an issue with that. Even though that's what people connect, you know, that's what the majority of the people might connect with spending with. Said, oh, it's Christmas, you give Christmas gifts. Even if they don't think of it as explicitly religious, it still is connected somehow to that tradition. And not connected to the traditions of members of, you know, minority religions in the community. So, I don't think it's an easy position, you know, to argue necessarily, because it's been, you know, it's been swamped by secular gift giving, but I still think it's there.
I think Glenn's point about trying to carve out that piece after all the public concern about it, for me, is the driving force here. I definitely respect your opinions and I appreciate you bringing them, but this is a Christian privileged society. Our money says in God we trust. We swear our presidents and on the Bible. I'm not saying it's right. I'm not saying I'm for that. I appreciate that you're raising this. If there's some way, I don't know, you said, you know, if we can make a statement, I don't even know that that's possible. I think it's highly desirable to recognize that not everybody is in support of that. Initially, when you said let them use other funds, I thought, great, it's a win-win. We get to raise this, flag this, and nothing really changes. They just spend the $22,000 somewhere else. But your point, I think, is really valid, that this is a big deal, and that just kind of, I don't know that us taking that stance, which I think is extremely intellectual and important, but not necessarily where the general public's mind lies, is what we're charged to do here. So I'm more concerned about the backlash of us saying, and by the way, because I don't think we have a separation of church and state, and so this is us trying to make a statement that we should, and I don't think it exists as we are in reality.
Any other comment?
I'm not sure what my comment is, because I'm on both sides of the issue. I think Dave's point is a very valid point. On the other hand, I'm assuming that this tree was not originally installed as a Christmas tree. I'm assuming it was installed as a tree and members of the community chose to use it for a particular purpose. And in envisioning the new park, people have said that that choice is something that they want the ability to continue to make in the new park. So. I think it is a Christian symbol. It's commercial, but at its heart, it's a Christian symbol. that choice, I think, was a choice made by private individuals to kind of adopt the tree, and I think we ought to allow that, because it is a community choice to adopt that. A large part of the community has made that choice to make that possible for them to do it. They're sort of continuing what was already there in the park. I think that reflects the community choice. I don't, in a sense, it does also constitute state public funding, not state public funding for it. But I think that's really taking it a bit far in terms of the analysis.
I think any statement that we make that divorces the state from religion is a good one. And if in fact this has been brought up as an issue by Dave, I fully support that. We're not funding the tree. The tree will be funded, you know, through the park grant or private funding. So, I mean, I think anything that we can do to further divorce the state from sanctioned religion is an important one. And I don't think we're going to put that in the condition. That's the condition, is that the park grant supports the tree. That's all we're saying. We're not going to do a religious explanation. But I'm really concerned. You know, the shit that's going on in Arkansas and Indiana, I mean, this stuff is crazy. And I think anything we can do to separate public funding from private, from what are construed as religious symbols, is a very important statement in this, you know, reactionary, you know, very reactionary times and places. So I fully support Dave's thing. And again, it's almost like semantics. The tree's going to be there. It's not going to fund it. It's just who funds it. Funds it out of the park grant.
Which is also public money.
Which is public.
Right. But at least it's not our, you know, at least we have control over our part of the public money. We're just saying we're not going to fund it with ours. Pay for it elsewhere. Pay for the park grant. They want to do that. Or privately fundraise. The tree will be there. I think that David can duck debt as the clock fundraiser and the tree fundraiser. He's not here, you know? You snooze, you lose.
So does that satisfy you that it's just simply stated that that's what happens, and that it's that, you know, and the people who've spoken to you about this know that this is what's behind it, but there's no public statement of why?
I'm not sure what it is that you're referring to.
Would it satisfy you just to have the condition say just that the money come from elsewhere?
Yeah, that was all I recognized. I didn't say anything about church and state being mentioned or the reasons why, just that aspect won't be funded by CPA. And that's really the intent. And that, you know, separation of church and state is a legal concept that's been battled out in the courts. And I think from a standpoint of the law, my read of it, we can do it. I think it's a larger question of being an inclusive community and practicing what we preach. And as much as the majority of the community may celebrate Christmas and may come out to adore that tree and recognize that it's commercial and may exercise its right from a religious perspective to celebrate that holiday or not, there are a lot of people in our community who don't and who bristle when they see Santa Claus riding around on our fire trucks because it's not their holiday. And I'm not one who advocates let's celebrate all the holidays of the property. This is a chunk of the budget, so I just assume not pay for that out of respect to everybody. But
it is one more, I have to make one more point. If it's a maple tree in the middle of the park that they strung lights on at the holiday season, and the maple tree was getting cut down and being replaced by another maple tree, would we be having the same discussion, or is it because it's an evergreen?
I think it's because millions of people across the United States, and what is a tradition, they go and they bring Christmas trees inside. They don't bring maple. I mean, if people brought maple trees inside, I would say I just think it's in the context of the Christmas holiday, we associate evergreens. Now, you could say it's a pagan symbol that was appropriated by the Christians, right, from Northern Europe, because they didn't have a lot of Christmas trees, probably. But, you know, so they
cut the cedars in Lebanon much before that. But I just, I think that it's hard for me. And again, I don't think it's popular, but I teach, and every day we say the Pledge of Allegiance, and every day we say the Pledge of Allegiance, I think of the decision West Virginia versus Barnett, which says there's no like more fixed principle that you should not be compelled to do something that's not in keeping with your belief. And I think what Dave's saying is that, and I don't know what this is, like, we're the community preservation, so does that mean we're majoritarian, or do we recognize that a really important part of this community is the recognition that people who are not the majority are valuable and should be treated with as much respect as the majority. And, so, and I just think that that's, you know, for me, and again, I'm sometimes on the flip side of this, because I say for the schools, I don't want you to recognize any holidays. And that makes some, you know, that means some people will be uncomfortable, because I say, I don't, you know, High Holy Days are in September, don't change the schedule unless you can make, you know, make a showing that actually we're gonna lose too many staff to have a functional school system. And people look at me and say, well, that's, you're discriminating against my religion. I'm saying, I don't want to get into the business of saying what's the religion that I want to, you know, say is appropriate. And I think that's where Dave's saying, if we said, well, let's fund the holiday tree, why is that the only, I mean, there are other holidays that have other symbols. Why wouldn't we want to include those in the park as well? So it's not an easy.
There's got to be some evergreens in the garden anyway.
I just want to clarify, I'm fully in support of, I just wonder about its place here, and I wonder about, so this condition gets put into the contract or into the award. So we in this room, and anybody watching this, knows that we talked about this, we feel strongly about this, perhaps if we agree to this, and so in this small and important way, we've made a statement. I mean, is that what's happening? Because will somebody look at the condition and say, what's this? Why is this here?
This would be in the council financial order. Mm-hmm. So that would no doubt get flagged in council and be discussed again. Mm-hmm. Unless we didn't want it in the order, only wanted it in the contract, which is another possibility too.
No, I just want to be clear. I appreciate that you're bringing that.
We could just recommend don't cut the tree down, then we don't get involved.
If there's no further discussion, we should probably take a vote on Dave's conditions so that we can all.
And my understanding is that these are order conditions.
What's that?
These are conditions for the council orders, correct?
Yes, okay. Yes. So I believe the condition is that the money that we are recommending not be spent on the relocation or installation of a new large pine tree. So would we allow them to plant, would other smaller pine trees be appropriate if they were consistent with the plantings? I mean, I
it's
think
not
that's
a pine
what
tree,
it was evergreen.
Evergreen. Okay. So because I mean that was Stephen Simpson did say, well, what if we planted right? What if we planted evergreens? So yeah. Would that be? I think the thing is that clearly they're trying to make a showpiece 22-foot tree,
yeah.
And it's more expensive if they did a Charlie Brown tree, and then people decided, you know, they'd be allowed to do a holiday display. So I think we're just saying no. I just want to get. I'm trying to get the.
No. I understand it. I'm wondering. This seems to be a meaty issue. Mm-hmm. We don't have to decide on this condition tonight.
No,
we don't
true.
Have to
that's
vote
true.
On it.
Okay.
I think at least the idea is out there,
okay.
For people to think about and conceptualize. Maybe there's a different way to say it. Maybe people will change their minds. Maybe I'll change my mind and figure out a different way to propose it so that it doesn't seem like a slap to anybody. But
yeah.
I would feel uncomfortable if I didn't mention it and have, this is the type of debate we should be having, debate or conversation. So I'm happy to table the motion
okay.
for now.
All right,
and revisit it if people want that.
I feel comfortable voting on that. I'm not sure we have to table it. People, I mean, do you want, you, if your mind's made up, what? I mean, are we going to change our minds in 2 weeks?
I could put it in the draft order and we can talk about it again next time.
I just didn't want people to feel on the spot. This is.
You've actually been talking about this right along, so I don't feel like it's the first time you've brought this to us.
I know, I just want to give everyone whatever comfortable space they need to make a reasonable decision on something. So.
I feel very uncomfortable with you giving me a comfortable space.
All right, so why don't we vote on it, and then if we feel in our heart very bad about our decision, we can come back to it. But so all those in favor of adding a condition that the tree that will be cut down in current plants not be replaced with a 22-foot specimen tree, say aye.
I'm sorry, can you say that?
So I'm saying that we will not, we are placing a condition that CPA funding not be used to replace the current pine tree that is not a Christmas tree.
Why don't we just say the grant will be used? It would be more positive.
Well, because then we would just say use it for everything but. I mean, we are singling out that it not be used for what has been presented to us in the plan is a 22-foot specimen evergreen. So I believe the vote was
right. And just to be clear, in phrasing it, to say that it can go forward, but just not.
Oh, right, absolutely. No, that's all I'm saying. The source of the funding. So
what happens if it falls off? What happens if they say they don't plant the tree? What's the public going to say then?
Yeah.
I'm just thinking that there's a big contingency that wants that tree.
Yeah.
And we can say plant it with somebody else's money. We can say go raise the funds. But we have the authority to provide the funds so that the tree is there, which is what all of this open deliberation has.
I understand. That's why I'm just, again, we're going to vote. We're going to see where the votes lie. So I believe there were one, two, how many in favor of the motion?
One, two, to the vote. Yeah.
Yes, so all in favor, raise their hands, please, so I can recognize. Okay, so that's four in favor. All opposed? Okay, so that's three. Abstaining? Okay, so we have, so the motion passes 4-3 with one abstention. So we had a second condition, which is that the existing evergreen be preserved in place. So that motion was made. Is there a second for discussion?
I'll second that motion.
You can't second that motion. I'm sorry, but is there a second to the motion?
Dave second.
Okay, Dave second. All right, so we do have a tree that is currently existing. It does not, obviously, it does not fit with the current design. Discussion on the motion to maintain the existing tree in place.
At the end of the night to say I've moved the tree, stay alive. But that's what I think what you're doing. If you say keep that tree, it's going to die.
Yeah. Oh, I think the tree's going to die.
I think when
can they move it and keep it alive? Move
no, it's the root ball. You have to have a root ball that's movable, and it's too big for that. Mm-hmm. And they're going to have to dig all around it.
All right.
I was trying to be cute, and it didn't come off well. But that's what I meant is that I don't think we can keep that. I don't think we can keep that tree and guarantee that it stays alive.
Well, I know I'm the only one interested in this tree, but I don't buy that argument. I think it looks fine to me. I don't see anything wrong with that tree. So I don't know. I know they're saying, oh, it's going to die.
Yeah. Would you envision bulldozers all over the park digging up ground everywhere around it?
Protect the trees. That all the trees are going to be protected, the trees that aren't going to be chopped down.
Right.
But no, I know, there are. I read the notes and there was a lot of concern about keeping that tree. So I really don't think that's true that the tree's going to die. I'm just being, I don't know what the word is for, but I just don't buy that argument.
All right, further discussion about keeping the existing tree. There's none. All in favor of the condition that we keep the tree? Opposed? All right, so that motion does not pass. Other conditions attached to our recommendation on the part?
I'm going to mention something that's not a condition.
Okay.
Following the presentation, I exchanged emails with Jim because there was an opinion about the call it the sidewalk head, the trailhead that ends at the crosswalk that is not. It's been a beef of mine. I keep raising the flag. And I think that I just want to say that that concern has again been communicated to the architect.
And I just had a question about, in some places, they put railings right, to make it very inconvenient for people to, you know, you put a railing, now of course the pedestrian trying to cross the railing gets crushed against the railing, but at least, right, people do not generally climb over a 3-foot railing. Or a fence. Is there any thought? I mean, you're the expert.
Yeah, the feeling, you know, I don't know that the design wants to feel like you're trying to block people out of the park. But I
would. But this would be right at curb edge.
Yep.
Right at road edge.
It was certainly talked about after we had the town.
Right.
My hope was that we would take the concrete, the granite benches. And make benches along there so that it would just guide people not to, you know, not to go over there. But the split of the sidewalk, there are many design solutions to control people's interest in going somewhere. And I think, I just look at it as if they didn't realize we were going to move the crosswalk. I didn't realize we were going to move the crosswalk. So it has been stated, I don't think it needs to be a condition, but I just wanted to say once again, that had been a part of the discussion, and I think it's not yet quite settled, is my hope.
Okay.
So what is the condition?
It's not.
It's not.
It's just me going on record as concerned once again.
With the crosswalk.
Wondering when we do an order that we give to the council, mm-hmm. there, that we might have a little bit more robust whereas clauses that describe some of the issues that we grapple with, like, you know, whereas the city, through its application in response to questions, is committed to replace movable furniture on 5-year intervals or whatever it is, mm-hmm. for the lifetime of the park, and whereas the city is committed to sufficient maintenance to keep up the park in whatever condition the architects describe. So it's clear that, you know, in for a diamond for a dollar, and so that we don't get those questions in return, we kind of lay out some of those things that, right,
sounds good.
Struggle with. Just to provide context, if we need to, assuming the vote on the Christmas tree holds, we can say something like, you know, whereas, you know, we recognize that it's perfectly appropriate to have the Christmas tree there, recognizing we have different constituencies in our town and have different religions, whereas the park grant can cover, you know, other aspects of this, to dissuade them from going that direction of not having a Christmas tree, but to lay out some of the reasoning. But I mean, those might be some ways that we make it more palatable, because I also don't want to see this thing fail for any reason. But just as we get a draft from Sarah, keep those things in mind and figure out a way to, you know, market this forward.
Sarah, do you know about the status of the granite blocks that they took out of the old railroad?
Because they kept talking
about on Earl Street.
Well, now they talk about the dam, but they're talking about if they don't get the dam, right? If that doesn't happen, they were saying, oh, well, then we'll have to use something else.
Right.
And as I drove by those the other day, I thought,
They're not very uniform. Some of those, a lot of the great ones have already been taken for seating along the bike paths, and probably will continue to do that, and what's left probably would be appropriate for seating. But there may be opportunity to use at least a few.
Yeah. Okay.
And when would we know about the feasibility of pulling them from the dam?
Definitely not before the next meeting. Probably not for months anyway, as that starts to be demolished. And there was some pushback from people, especially who live in the Upper Roberts Meadow area, about the blocks being taken away from the. Yes.
Roberts Meadow Dam, is that the one we did not fund?
Yes.
Yes. All right, any other conditions before we adjourn for the night?
Is there, I think it would be nice to make some sort of statement encouraging as much as possible the planting of native species. I don't think there should be a condition, but is there a...
Native species?
Yeah.
I thought that was one of the big selling points.
They
primarily were.
But yeah, but just to reiterate that, I don't know if that's a condition, or just a whereas, another whereas or something.
We could communicate with the designer, because I think he would probably like it, whereas the park is designed with native species that can be maintained in the effort and will thrive.
There's a kind of catch-22 to that, in that what's native here, based on what the past climate will be. No, I'm not teasing. Our sustainability plan moves in a different planting zone for us in the future. So, whatever that's for.
And is there another whereas or condition looking at both stormwater, sewer, and water enterprise funds, as well as utility funds, to encourage the utility funds for the underground wire relocation?
So actually, that's interesting. So they're using some of the stormwater utility fund to build the bioswale.
Yes.
So will they use some of the stormwater utility fund to maintain the bioswale?
Right. Seems like appropriate.
I mean, because that will be right. One of the major concerns will be what that's right. That's one of those key natural areas that everyone's concerned about. You'll put those nice plants in, and then they won't be properly maintained. So, right. And you're saying, where will that money come from?
Yeah.
So, if at least one of the sources, it's still tax money, but it might make it easier for them
to see something.
What's that?
We'll look at the bioswale instead of just writing a check.
No, I mean, I think that's true. I think the DPW is in a very tough spot. I mean, they couldn't possibly say, no, we can't maintain this park.
No.
So they're going to say, yes, we can maintain this park, but it's going to take some additional manpower.
Right.
Yeah.
And just to clarify, we awarded the remainder of funds to the clock, so we also need an order for that.
No, we're still waiting on, we're waiting on information about the status of the clock.
You want it now?
Do
you want that now?
What now?
Wayne got back to him.
Oh, he did.
He said $3,000 would allow us to move it, store it, and purchase a key part, the ornamentation that would otherwise not be available later. We're hoping to be able to store it at the police station.
Wow.
At no cost.
I vote we allocate $3,000.
Okay, is there a second? Is that all in favor? Okay, that's unanimous. So that was.
Thank you, sir. That was excellent.
All right, is there a motion to adjourn until our meeting on April
22nd?
Yep. All in favor?
Sarah will not be here on the 22nd.